Welcome to the Wall Street Lab podcast, where we interview top financial professionals and deconstruct their practices to give you an insider look into the world of finance.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Wall Street Lab podcast. I'm extra excited about today's episode as we cover the big topic of impact and ESG investments. Our guest today is Jacco Minnaar. Jacco is the chair of the management board and the managing director of Triodos Investment Management, a globally active multi-billion dollar impact investor. Jacco has 25 years of experience in the financial and investment industry. Prior to his current position as chair, he served Triodos across various positions, including director of energy and climate, fund manager of Triodos Fair Share Fund, and regional manager of Africa and Latin America. Before joining Triodos in 2006, he managed the financial markets development program of the International Finance Corporation, or IFC, in the Mekong region. Jacco also holds a Master of Science degree in Industrial Engineering and Management Science and is a CFA charterholder. Jacco explains to us what is impact investing and why it is so important, and how you can differentiate yourself as an impact investor. We also debunk myths about impact investing and lagging returns by looking at the performance drivers of sustainable investments. And of course, we speak about Triodos' investment management process, the areas they invest in, and how they choose their portfolio companies. And as per usual, if you like the episode, please leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts from. Now, without further ado, our interview with Jacco Minnaar. Jacco, hello and welcome to the Wall Street Lab podcast. I'm really excited about today's episode. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Andreas. Very happy to be here.
Jacco, can you tell us a bit about your background and what do you do?
So I'm Jacco Minnaar. I am the chairman of the management board of Triodos Investment Management. I will tell you a bit more about Triodos Investment Management in a bit, but let me start with a short personal background. I have been with Triodos for the last 14 years, sort of in different jobs. But before I joined Triodos, I started my career with different parts of the ING group, so a commercial bank. I then, 6-7 years later, followed my wife to Cambodia, where she started working for the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights. And I basically was jobless. But very soon I landed my first 3-month consultancy with the IFC. One thing led to another. And by the time we left, 6 years later, I was responsible for all the financial markets activities of the IFC in Cambodia, Vietnam and Laos. Very interesting times. So basically what you could say is that I went from a commercial bank to a development finance institution. And now at Triodos, where we are 100% commercial, but also 100% about impact. So let me tell you just a little bit more about Triodos Investment Management. And I'm sure later on we'll have more time to get into that. But Triodos Investment Management only invests in impact. We have about 4.9 billion euros in assets under management. Roughly half of that is invested through the stock exchange. And the other half is invested to impact private debt and equity funds that invest in three themes. They invest in social financial inclusion. A lot of that is what used to be called microfinance and is now much broader. They invest in energy and climate, renewable energy mostly. As Triodos, we are also a leader in that area, doing between 80 and 100 deals every year, mostly small and mid-sized deals. The third area is food and agriculture, where we also have funds that invest both in the Netherlands and Europe, as well as globally in emerging markets.
Can you tell us what got you interested in finance in the first place? So I know you have a master's degree in industrial engineering and management science. What got you hooked in finance and then later on into sustainable finance?
That's a good question. I think, to be honest, my first steps in finance with the different parts of ING, my conviction wasn't as strong yet back then. But I think we should go back a little bit further, because after I finished my studies, I went on a trip around the world for almost a year. And even before, I did an internship with Unilever in Indonesia. And when traveling to those countries that I've now come to know as emerging markets, I realized that the image that I had was totally wrong. You know, in the 80s, when I grew up, we were donating money for Ethiopia because we needed to help the victims of famine. And that was the image that I had of those countries. And when actually traveling there, I found that the levels of entrepreneurship are enormous, but so are the barriers. So I always wanted to go back and basically help remove some of those barriers so that people can actually build their own lives. And when I ended up in the banking industry plays a very important role in giving individuals and companies the instruments that help them to grow their business. But in emerging markets, those didn't exist, or they didn't exist to the quantity and quality levels that you would want. When I sort of landed in Cambodia, it was very clear for me that I wanted to work in the field of economic and financial sector development, and finally managed to do so.
I like your story because I can very well relate. I did my master's in Singapore, and I've been traveling to all those emerging countries as well. And I just saw the disparity between where they could be versus where they are and what an impact one could have. And that's actually why I'm super excited personally about this interview we have today. Could you lead us a bit through what is impact investing? And I want to give it a spin because you said you have 50% public equity and 50% about private investments. Based on your public markets investment strategies, can you explain the difference between the different sorts or the different steps of impact investing? And I mean ethical or exclusion based, ESG based, and really impact investing.
That's a very big question, Andreas. So I think we are going to cut it up a little bit in the conversation, because you started with basically what is impact investing. I want to go back to 1980, 40 years ago, when Triodos Bank was founded. If you look at the founders, we had four founders at Triodos Bank, why they started a new bank. All of them had some background in the financial sector, but they realized that banks themselves, but also their depositors and their investors, basically were only after a financial return. And most people, especially depositors, didn't seem to realize that their money was not just used to return a financial return in the form of an interest rate, but was actually used to make decisions on what happens in society and what doesn't. It, at the core, impact investing is about the fact that with money you make choices, and they decide what actually happens and what doesn't happen in the real economy. And that's why Triodos Bank got started. And that premise is still very relevant today. Now, we have to realize we call ourselves an impact investor. That means that we try to invest for positive impact, a positive impact risk return. But in fact, all investors have an impact. Only in some cases, it's not as positive. And so all investments have an impact. That is, I think, a very important notion. Now, what you correctly stated is that if you look at all of the investments, then there is sort of a range. On the left-hand side, we have investments that are not screened and that are not managing any impact except for the financial side. That is still the bulk of investments today. All the way on the other side of the scale, we have full-on impact investing. And the way I categorize it, in between, if you come from no screening at all, then we have some minor exclusions. We see that there are more and more and more funds that at least have some exclusions that say we don't invest in pornography, we don't invest in tobacco or things like that. Then when you talk about ESG and you go one step further, often the first step is that it is approached only from a risk perspective. So it is screening out the bad risks. Very important, but only yet another step. Then if we really talk about full-on ESG integration, it should not only look at the negatives, but also look at the positives. And then positive screening comes into play. Ultimately, you really talk about impact investing. And impact investing for me is, I follow the definition of the GIN, the Global Impact Investing Network. We were a founder of that network. It is now the largest network of its kind in the industry. It basically states very clearly, if you are an impact investor, you consciously manage for either a social or an environmental type impact, while at the same time, you want to have a financial return. And so it really has the triple bottom line. And it has the conscious part. It means that you define upfront the impact you want to have, the risk you want to have, and the return. Whereas in mainstream investment, we only define the risk return profile that we are after. And then it means that you also, you manage all three, you measure all three, and you report on all three. Now, you then talked about that we have roughly half of our business through the stock exchange and half of our business through impact private debt and equity. In impact private debt and equity, we, in a private market, pick a project or a company where we can play a role with either private debt or private equity. And then it's very clear the type of impact that you could have. But in public markets, you can also have that impact, and you do so in several ways. The first one is that you do your homework. You actually screen companies, not only on the financial side, way, but also on the impact side, on the ESG side. And what makes us different, I think, and there are a few that are all the way on that side as well, is that we have those teams internally, and they sit next to each other, and they work together. So at every stage of the process, whether it is sort of picking from all the companies in the world that you could invest in to the shortlist, we try to look both at the impact side as well as the financial side before we continue to the next phase. So that's really an integrated approach. That's before you even invest. And then, of course, when you invest, you can engage with companies to see whether over time they can continue to develop in the right direction. And ultimately, if they don't, or if they go in a wrong direction, then you can vote with your feet and disinvest.
That sounds actually like more work, right? You have three bottom lines that you're looking after right now. It sounds like more work. You narrow down strongly your investable portfolio. Does that have any negative impacts on revenue?
Excellent question, Andreas, because you are right. It is more work. If we take a step back and we look at the investment industry today, then we see basically a watershed. On the one hand, we see that in the last years, more and more money has gone to passive investing, and passive investing has become purely a cost play. As so in 2018, 2019, more than 50%, probably almost three quarters of the new money went to three large players globally, BlackRock being the largest one. They can play in that segment because they are extremely large, have economies of scale, and can offer the lowest cost. So if you're tracking passive investment, then cost is basically the only differentiator, because you're all trying to do exactly the same thing. So from a cost point of view, that's great. But all the way on the other side of the range is where you have specialized players who are front runners in what they do and therefore still have a competitive edge. That is where we are playing. So what we see in 2018, 2019, we ourselves in 2019, we grew from 4.2 to 4.9 billion euros in assets under management. So that's a healthy growth. And investors are still coming to us because we are distinguishing ourselves. And we see that themes like emerging markets, private debt, private equity, deep integration of ESG factors, but also some other things that we may not do as much, very specific small and mid-cap strategies. If you have a strategy that, one, you have really the expertise that has a good track record and you can distinguish yourself, then there's still a lot of room to play on that side as well. The companies in our industry, because the industry at large is not growing a lot. In 2018, it was actually going down a bit. 2019, it grew a little bit. But it's mostly that assets are shifting from some asset managers to others. The ones who have difficulty are the ones who are stuck in the middle. Because if you are relatively large, then I'm talking hundreds of billions of assets under management, then you are still very small compared to the trillions of BlackRock. So you cannot play in that low cost segment. So everybody now sort of, basically every second product that we see that is launched has either the word sustainable or impact in its name, but not everybody is as deep green impact as we are, I think.
I want to follow up with two questions. The first is, who are your investors? Is it companies or people that look actively for green or impact investings? Or is it also companies that I don't really care about the impact in quotation marks, but we look at the financial return and we look at a correlation benefit, a risk management benefit to it?
Our investors are in different segments. As Triodos Investment Management, we only have professional clients. But the first segment of those clients are banks, private banks, who in turn are actually dealing with retail customers. And so the asset owner, in our case, is often a retail investor, ultimately, who from our point of view is behind either a private bank or another bank. And the second segment that we have are the professional and institutional investors. So we see that both segments are investing in our solutions and our products. Your question is, why do they invest? The way we position ourselves is that we say long-term, impact, risk return can go hand in hand, and you should actually invest in our products if you have that impact focus, still want to get a very decent risk return. And we can talk a bit more about risk return later, longer term, but you should have some level of patience. You know, our products are not products for people who shift their investments on a daily or even weekly or monthly basis. You have to have a slightly longer horizon. Obviously, there is a range of parties in there, and traditionally many of them focus mostly on the impact side and then also on the finance side. But we also have investors who describe more to the view that you said, that basically say it's primarily the diversification benefits. It is the relatively good risk return because the risks are lower, that they find interesting. And we can talk a bit more about that if you want, Andreas, because we have some interesting research and also some findings as of late.
Yes, please.
Well, late last year, we actually asked Ortec, an independent party, to look at some of our private debt and equity funds who have a track record of 10-year plus. And so a really decent track record. And what they did is they looked at the risk return and especially whether these funds can have a diversification benefit in a portfolio that is already well diversified. And they found that they do, because on most of the characteristics of the portfolio, they have a very low correlation with the general markets, or sometimes even a negative correlation. And so what we saw is that in general, the way we do these long-term investments with the focus not only on the financial side, but also on the impact and ESG side, tends to lead to products in those cases that have maybe a slightly lower risk than you would expect, still a decent return, so interesting risk-return profile, but also low diversification. And that last thing makes it really attractive from a financial point of view. Now, the question is, of course, whether all of that holds up in the crisis, because in crisis, the correlations may change. And what we see is that the crisis that we have today is a totally different crisis than the global financial crisis of 2008. Because back then, it was basically the financial sector itself that was the culprit with the toxic mortgage products. But now we see that almost every human being in the whole world gets hit by corona, then gets hit by a lockdown. Whole economies get hit, so there's no way to hide. Everybody gets hit. Still, I think what we see is that our private debt and equity funds are holding up quite well. I mean, it's a risky world today, so we are managing that on a day-to-day basis. And what we've also seen is that on the public side, where we invest through the stock exchange, our funds have done better than the market. So they've shown positive outperformance. And we have also seen that where in the market in March, Morningstar saw outflows that they hadn't even seen in 1 week in the global financial crisis. Our funds didn't see that type of outflow. And in on the stock market, actually, they're growing again. So I want to be very careful because we live in risky times. And it's not like, you know, our funds will not get hit at all. In fact, they have been hit, but they seem to have been hit on the public sector side less than the market. And those diversification benefits are still there.
Let me put you on the spot and ask your opinion on a little performance attribution. So many people would argue, often fund managers, you could attribute their performance or outperformance to several things. What do you think is the source of outperformance for you? Is it skill? Is it luck? Or is it that you do impact investing?
It's a very important question. If you ask some of the behavioral finance guys, they will say, well, let's not underestimate luck. I will not do that. But we have fund managers and they make these type of analysis, of course. I think if you look at the outperformance that we have now, it can be attributed to several things. It is one that we felt that valuations in the stock markets were too high. We had felt that for about 1.5 years. We had a relatively high cash position, so conservative position. That contributed to outperformance. Two is because of our impact approach, we have a low exposure to oil, no exposure to oil, actually. And of course, this corona crisis actually was not just a corona crisis. It was also an oil crisis at the same time. We also have very low exposure to the large financials. And those were two of the sectors that were very hardly hit. So a lot of the outperformance is also because we don't allocate to those sectors. And the third thing is that in general, the companies that we have invested in, because we do this very deep ESG test and we check for positive and long-term impact, they seem to be surviving a bit better than the average market. And that might be because they have slightly higher buffers and are there for the long term themselves. But I totally understand your question. And I think we probably need more research and continued research to actually prove that.
Would you say that a company that focuses on having an impact and so scores high on your scorecard is a more robust company?
Yeah, I don't think you can say that for the individual companies per se, but if you talk large numbers, probably yes. I think there is also a growing base of evidence. And again, it seems that the COVID crisis itself is again underwriting that. And this is not just our research, but this is the research at large that we see on ESG investments, that they are performing on the long term similar or even slightly better than mainstream investments. And my best hypothesis would be that that is because the ESG factors themselves often indicate if companies score well on those, they probably are better managed in general, take lower risks and have a more longer term approach. Therefore, indeed, have bigger buffers and are more robust. They are not in the game of optimizing quarterly results and being efficient every quarter, which you, if you do that, you run the risk that all the buffers are not there. I mean, we know, of course, that typical private equity buy stock, then leverages to the max, already gets back the investment through the first dividend. And that is one, a short-term play, but two, also a very risky play that if you then get into trouble, you don't have the buffers that you need as a truly long-term company.
You said in a sentence that you score the companies. How do you score if a company has impact and has positive impact?
We have four different strategies. And so for each of these strategies, we have our own systems to do so. But at the core, it comes down to that you have to start with what is the theory of change? Why do we think if we invest in this type of companies that it is going to make a difference? And so that's where we start. What is the theory of change? And so, for example, in microfinance, where we have invested for a long time, we say the theory of change is that if you have people who have no way of managing their own lives, if you give them the means to manage their own lives, they're going to have a longer term horizon, they're going to make smarter decisions, and they're going to be able to grow their business, which means that they will have more buffers if they have problems in their own lives. And that means that their children can grow to school. So that will help improve the quality of life. So it starts at that sort of level. Then you define the specific objectives that you have with your investment. Then you define the criteria that you have, and then you measure them, you manage them, and you report on them. And so we do that for each one of our strategies. And for example, on another strategy on the public market side, you can also see what the CO2 footprint is of all of our investments and how that relates to the benchmark. They have a lower CO2 footprint than the benchmark.
Could you give us an example of maybe one case that you just maybe think of on how this process would look like? So you start with theory of change, probably a big trend you see with an objective and a criteria and how and what you measure.
Let's take one of our other sectors. Energy and climate, renewable energy. Basically, it starts with that we have a vision paper where we think the sector is going and where it should go. In energy and climate, for a long time, there was a bit of a debate and a fight about whether climate change was real. We are beyond that now. I think after Paris, the whole world agrees that climate change is real and we should tackle it. The discussion now is much more about how quickly we are making the changes. We have a vision paper on what we think should happen. It states things as you switch from fossil fuel to renewable energy, obviously, but it also states things about energy efficiency. We have to lower the total amount of energy that we use to do the same thing. It also states that we have to solve the system question on how we are going to integrate all of that renewable energy into a stable energy system, because renewable energy is intermittent. Solar only produces when the sun shines, and wind energy only produces when the wind blows. So if they both do very hard, you have energy in abundance. And if they don't somewhere in winter, then you may not have energy at all. So we need storage. We need demand supply systems. We need other things to make the system as a whole work. And a fourth pillar for us in that strategy is that we also think you should do so by actually crowding in the public, something you could call energy democracy. It should not just be three big global companies who do this, but we should get buy-in from the people. Otherwise, we get effects like not in my backyard, and then everybody is in favor as long as, you know, they don't have to live with it. So that is the vision that we have. And then basically, And this is a relatively simple one. If we do an individual investment, we look at many more factors. But for each single investment, we measure how much renewable energy it produces and how much CO2 is then avoided that doesn't have to be done by coal or by lignite or by oil or gas. And then we measure that every year. And we are now in the process of actually coming up with an objective that is scientifically based and in line with Paris. We are quite confident that we are, because we don't do any oil and gas and we only do renewable energy. And if you look at the whole of Triodos, of course, we have still some CO2 that we ourselves actually are emitting. So do the companies that we invest in. But then we have a huge bunch CO2 avoided. That is because of the renewable energy projects that we invest in. And we even have also some CO2 sequestration, meaning that we take CO2 out of the air because some of the projects that we invest in that have to do with nature.
I think this gives a very good sense of what is important on the impact side of an investment. In your typical investment, what's the percentage of factors that go into how much impact do I have versus how much return do I have? Is there a threshold? Would you say, okay, we only invest in investments that give us a 5% annual return at minimum and have X percent better impact? Or is there a threshold? How is your sense on that? What matters in which proportion?
We measure both sides. There are thresholds, but I would say that we have sort of different categories of thresholds. So on the impact side, we have no-goes. And so these are things where we say, if this is the case, we will never invest. For example, we don't invest in nuclear. We don't invest in coal. We don't invest in oil. There, we don't even look at it. This is what we call our minimum standards. And so we have minimum standards, which are a threshold. We say below that, we simply don't invest. Above that, we try to optimize our impact while at the same time having a good financial return. And the financial return that we are after obviously depends on the specific fund and the specific strategy. I'll give you an example of private equity. With one of my former employers in private equity, the threshold was 25%. If you wanted to bring an investment proposal to the investment committee, it had to have a 25% projected return or otherwise it would be shut down, regardless of the impact. What was a bit funny is that if we look back at the 20-year track record of that same company, we actually managed to get an 8% return. So what I often saw was that we were also really writing those proposals to get the 25% return, but it was really a relatively optimistic scenario because that was not what the whole sector was actually realizing. In Triodos, in a comparable situation, we would not say, look, 5% is enough, but we are looking more for 12 to 15%, but then also actually ending up relatively close to that percentage. And if you look at our financial markets funds and the private equity that they do, they have historically had performance that is above 15%, even though we were not looking for more. I think what is important is to be realistic and to really, in an investment committee, challenge each other and really have an open discussion and be prepared not to do an investment if too many people in the investment committee are not in it. And be a bit careful if you put the benchmarks very high, then you may just be writing towards that benchmark.
You said earlier that the typical private equity fund, they buy a company, they leverage it to the maximum, and that's how they get their return. If you manage to get the same or similar returns like those, do you also use that much of leverage? And if not, why is the space not super crowded from every private equity investor? Because you get the same returns just by being impactful.
There are different private equity strategies, and we are not a leveraged buyout specialist. What we tend to do is much more early stage or growth equity, where we invest in a Series B or a Series C, sometimes a Series A, and it is really about there is a proof of concept or there is even almost profitability. There's some sales at least, and we're trying to grow something that both has a positive impact and also will then get a higher turnover and ultimately a higher profit. But we are not in the game of financially structuring this to get a good return. We are really in the game of having a business that provides a service to society or to the environment that makes sense and that can also have a decent return on the long term and then grow it.
I want to wrap up in just a few minutes to let you get along with your day. I noticed you are a CFA charter holder. And because our listeners are often young professionals, students, looking to experts like yourself, where can they go and what skills do they need to be there? So let me ask you, do you have any career advice, and what is for you the value of certifications like the CFA?
Well, let me start with the last one. When I was at the different parts of ING Group, I was not a banker's banker. So I was not in credit. What I realized at some point in time is that it does make sense to really understand the sector and the business that you are in. And that is why I started with my CFA, ultimately became an investor, and then became a manager and a managing director now in the investment industry. I think it makes sense, even if you want to be a manager, to at least realize that if you have more than one skill, you are more useful. So in general, if you have more than one skill, then you are more flexible, but also more useful. And especially if you can combine those skills, then you can be relatively unique. If we talk about, you know, listeners' advice, I find it very difficult because everybody, I think, has to find their own path. But let me say this. A couple of times in my life, I made big decisions, you know, like when I followed my wife to Cambodia, or just after my studies when I could have accepted a job immediately, but I decided to go traveling for 10 months. I would say that if you have the risk appetite, don't hesitate, because if you take those type of risks, they almost always pay off. So don't hesitate to take a relatively big step into the unknown and follow your heart. Or as we say at Triodos, use your head, but follow your heart.
I think those are great words to end the podcast. Use your head, but follow your heart. I love it. That's going to be the motto of the show. Jacco, thank you so much for your insights into impact investing. Thank you for the work that you do. I wish you all the best of returns, but also most of all, impact. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andreas. And thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening to the Wall Street Lab podcast. For the show notes and much more, visit us at www.thewallstreetlab.com. To see what we're up to before anyone else, subscribe to our newsletter on our website and follow us on Facebook and Twitter.
Disclaimer. Information contained in this podcast constitutes the opinions of individuals and should not be treated as investment, tax, financial, or legal advice. We take no responsibility for the accuracy of any statements made in this podcast. This podcast is for informational and educational purposes only, and it does not contain an offer to sell or buy any sort of financial products and should not be treated as advertisement for such. Any copying, distribution, or reproduction of this podcast without the prior permission of the creators of the podcast is strictly prohibited.